So this talk is on hemoglobin A1C, and I'm very glad. This is my fourth trip to India. I've been to Mumbai four times. The first time was quite challenging in Patna. Last year we had a one-month holiday. We went up north and we loved it. And my wife wants to come back next year, so today I'm by myself. So I travelled from way down there in Melbourne to Mumbai. And of course, this map is relevant to the lecture today, because this is the map of undiagnosed diabetes around the world. And as you would be aware, China and India have the most undiagnosed diabetics in the world. The reason why beta thalassemia was causing interference in the hemoglobin A1C assay wasn't so much because of the beta thalassemia protein itself. It was because patients with beta thalassemia have high levels of hemoglobin F. And hemoglobin F is alpha gamma. There's no beta subunit, so it can't be glycated. So it's important to recognize that there are two different issues with thalassemia. One is, does it cause an analytical interference? And is that analytical interference fetal hemoglobin? And then there's another issue which I'll come to soon. So hemoglobinopathy is very important across the world, particularly across the equator, as we all know, because of malaria protection and so on. And I don't need to tell this audience how common various types of hemoglobinopathies are in India. So it's important to understand, and this is a beta thalassemia, which varies slightly from state to state in India. And here's another sort of the different forms of beta thalassemia and their different prevalences in each of the states. More recently, Randy Little and colleagues have looked at the impact of hemoglobin F on different methods. And you can see that other than this affinity method, where there was a significant interference from hemoglobin F, the other methods were less affected by hemoglobin F. And so in our study, where we looked at all the modern methods, we looked at the interference by hemoglobin F. And the truth is, every method is interfered by hemoglobin F, because hemoglobin F cannot be glycated. If you have 10% hemoglobin F, your hemoglobin A1C will be 10% lower. So, and manufacturers, including Abbott, say, well, most patients don't have 10%. They might only have 3 or 4%, in which case the interference is insignificant. But if the hemoglobin F is above 10%, you must consider it and correct. And we also looked at hemoglobin C, E, S, and D traits. And generally, of all of the common methods, enzymatic, the new ion exchange methods and so on, they're very resistant to low levels of these hemoglobinopathies. They've been designed to not be reacted by them. The full-blown thalassemia major, of course, they're going to be connected. But again, you have to ask, why would that happen? Well, here is the Abbott enzymatic assay for hemoglobin C and S. And you can see there's very little interference in modern methods from the hemoglobinopathies. And another article saying that hemoglobin variants S, C, D, E, and E do not interfere with the enzymatic assay, but hemoglobin F above 10% interferes with the assay. Now, another issue which people cross, say the unreliability of hemoglobin A1C, is that in iron deficiency, hemoglobin A1C may be unreliable. And rather than in iron deficiency, so when you're iron deficient, your hemoglobin A1C might be 5.4, and when you're not iron deficient, it's 5.3. So that's statistically significant, but clinically insignificant. 0.1% of a shift in hemoglobin A1C is smaller than your analytical variation. So this is something to consider. Now, why is hemoglobin A1c higher in iron deficiency? Because in iron deficiency, the red cells have to live longer. They're so precious that you've made one with a bit of iron, you don't want to destroy it in 90 days. You want to keep it for 120 days. And that means it's got a greater chance to accumulate glucose, and the A1c is a little bit higher, not a lot. And we've known that for, again, many years, that the mean red blood cell age, if the cells age longer, your hemoglobin A1c might be a bit higher. If the cells are destroyed faster, then the hemoglobin A1c will be lower. And this is much more significant today than the hemoglobinopathies, the estimation of red cell turnover. Because once red cell turnover falls below the usual range, the hemoglobin A1c can drop very dramatically. So patients with very fast red cell turnover, hemolytic anemia, hypersplenism, they have misleading hemoglobin A1c. Now in my laboratory there's a simple rule. If you're anemic, you probably have very poor red cell turnover, so don't trust the hemoglobin A1c. But if your hemoglobin is normal, you're probably keeping up with your red cell losses, and the hemoglobin is far more reliable. Now, hemoglobin A1c we love because it correlates so well with the complications of diabetes. The complications of diabetes include hyperlipidemia and cardiovascular risk, neuropathy, nephropathy, and retinopathy. And in the DCCT trial, we knew that once you got above 8%, the risk of those complications rose exponentially. And that established the use of hemoglobin A1c as a predictor of complications in diabetes. But the questions were, in the early stages, why can't we use it to diagnose diabetes? Because these people down here with hemoglobin A1cs below about 7 had no risk of complications of diabetes. That means they're not diabetic. And that was in type 1 diabetics, and the UKPDS repeated the same thing for type 2 diabetics. And in type 2 diabetics, once you drop below about 6 or 7, the risks of complications were minimal. In other words, you probably didn't have diabetes. But the problem was, even though we knew that at the turn of the century, that our methods weren't good enough. 7% in one lab could be 9% in another lab. And so people said, we can't say 7% is normal because labs have different numbers. And so this is how variable hemoglobin A1cs were in the CAP surveys until 2008, when people pushed for standardisation of hemoglobin A1c. And after the IFCC standardisation was introduced, then people said, now we can use hemoglobin A1c as a diagnostic tool, and any hemoglobin A1c that's above 6.5% means diabetes, because that's when the risk of complications start to rise. That's when, above 6.5, that's when retinopathy starts to occur. So we could define diabetes using hemoglobin A1c because it correlated with the risks of diabetes and we had a standardised assay. Nevertheless, people didn't trust A1c and they were thinking, well, we're using the glucose tolerance and glucose. How can we use glucose and hemoglobin A1c to diagnose diabetes? And I published many papers 5 or 10 years ago with Susan Manley, who was in the DCCT study, trying to work out an algorithm how we could use glucose and hemoglobin A1c to increase our confidence. But I'm telling you, glucose is rubbish. So all of these algorithms, which I've had a part of, I don't believe in anymore, using glucose and A1c. And so we published a paper with John Liu, my colleague, where we looked at the classification according to GTT and the classification according to hemoglobin A1c. And yes, by the time your hemoglobin A1c is 6.9%, almost all of them are being diagnosed as diabetic by the glucose tolerance test. But what was starting to worry us was, what about here at 6.0? The chance of diabetes was low, according to the glucose tolerance test, but the chance of pre-diabetes was quite significant. So why are we only interested in diabetes with hemoglobin A1c? Shouldn't we be interested in how hemoglobin A1c also picks up pre-diabetes? And this is hemoglobin A1c against the prediction of diabetes. So if your hemoglobin A1c is 5%, your chance of diabetes in the next year is zero. Whereas if your hemoglobin A1c is 6%, which is not yet diabetic, your chance of becoming diabetic in the next 1 year is 7.5%. So 1 in 10 patients or more will have diabetes in 1 year. And the A1C is telling us that. And this is such an important paper by Selvin and co. Because what they looked at was the risk of cardiovascular disease. Not retinopathy or nephropathy, cardiovascular disease. And you can see when the hemoglobin A1C is 6.5% here, where you're diabetic, cardiovascular disease rises way before that, at about 5.5%. So I have to agree with previous speakers that cholesterol is not as important, in my mind, as hemoglobin A1C, particularly in populations that have got obesity and diabetes. So hemoglobin A1C not only correlates against cardiovascular disease, but the risk of dying from any cause, including stroke, rises at 5.5%. And when you look at the individual components of the pre-diabetic metabolic syndrome, which is we recognise as the deadly quartet that causes cardiovascular disease, all of those parameters, whether it be hypertension, hypertriglyceridemia, or low HDL, they don't occur at 6.5, they occur at from 5.5%. So A1C can be used, and I think it will be used, to define metabolic syndrome. In America, they use 5.7 and above as an impaired A1C, a pre-diabetic state. In New Zealand, they also use a hemoglobin A1C of 40 millimoles per mole to define pre-diabetes. Now, is that premature? This is just another Korean study predicting. What happens with insulin? If the metabolic syndrome is hyperinsulinemia, when does insulin start to rise? Insulin starts to rise at hemoglobin A1Cs of 5.5 to 5.9. And if we look at C-peptide, which is an integrator of insulinemia, this is a very interesting graph for those of you interested. When a patient's hyperinsulinemic, it's not when they're diabetic, it's not when they're normal, it's when they're pre-diabetic. So hemoglobin A1C can identify hyperinsulinemia and cardiovascular risk. Now there's one problem though. I'm telling you how important the cutoff for 5.5 is. There's one problem. When we look at laboratories, when they measure 6.5, the 6.5 when you go from one lab to another with a standardised assay might be anywhere between 6.3 and 6.7. But a level of 5.5 with current methods could be anywhere between 5.2 and 6.3. So the problem is our standardisation of assays at levels of 5.5% and our precision of 5.5% isn't good enough to diagnose pre-diabetes. That's why we need assays with CVs of 1% and better calibration at 5.5%. So when we look at pre-diabetes, now this is pre-diabetes in India. Remember, diabetes was 67 million. This is pre-diabetics, and India is the world leader for pre-diabetics. We've beaten the Americans here, and in 20 years' time, we'll move even further ahead in terms of pre-diabetes. That's not something to be proud of, by the way. And when we look at diabetes, if we don't do anything, the prevalence of diabetes will go from 69 million to 100. There'll be twice as many diabetics in the year 2040. You still won't overtake China as the most diabetics. They're growing their diabetics very quickly as well. But this is what we want to prevent. And what I'm saying to you is we need good hemoglobin A1Cs to pick up pre-diabetes so we can prevent the progression to diabetes. So in India, the issues with hemoglobin A1C measurements are the population is aging. These are the reasons why we should do hemoglobin A1C testing, the best test for diabetes and pre-diabetes. The population is aging, healthcare costs are going to blow out, and the diabetes prevalence is just too great. The reasons not to do hemoglobin A1C, assay reliability is diminishing as a reason. The assays are becoming far more reliable. And the cost is also diminishing as the volumes of testing increase. So I'd like to thank the APPI for inviting me, Abbott, the local manager, Randish and Si Ling. I'd like to thank my collaborators in all my hemoglobin A1C work for the opportunity of doing the research. And I'd like to thank my daughter, Louisa, who has type 1 diabetes. And that's why I'm so passionate about diabetes and its monitoring and its proper treatment. So thank you very much. Thalassemias, but here is an older study, 1993, about the impact of thalassemia on hemoglobin A1C. And you can see that there are some methods here. This is the old Bio-Rad gel filtration column, which had an interference from thalassemia, a positive interference from thalassemia. Now, there are two aspects of the interference from thalassemia that I want to discuss. Even back then, in 1984, people realized that the reason why beta thalassemia was causing interference in the hemoglobin A1C assay wasn't so much because of the beta thalassemia protein itself. It was because patients with beta thalassemia have high levels of hemoglobin F. And hemoglobin F is alpha-gamma. There's no beta subunit, so it can't be glycated. So it's important to recognize that there are two different issues with thalassemia. One is, does it cause an analytical interference? And is that analytical interference fetal hemoglobin? And then there's another issue which I'll come to soon. So hemoglobinopathy is very important across the world, particularly across the equator, as we all know, because of malaria protection and so on. And I don't need to tell this audience how common various types of hemoglobinopathies are in India. So it's important to understand, and this is a beta thalassemia, which varies slightly from state to state in India. And here's another sort of the different forms of beta thalassemia and their different prevalences in each of the state. More recently, Randy Little and colleagues have looked at the impact of hemoglobin F on different methods. And you can see that other than this affinity method where there was a significant interference from hemoglobin F, the other methods were less affected by hemoglobin F. And so in our study where we looked at all the modern methods, we looked at the interference by hemoglobin F. And the truth is, every method is interfered by hemoglobin F, because hemoglobin F cannot be glycated. If you have 10% hemoglobin F, your hemoglobin A1C will be 10% lower. So, and manufacturers, including Abbott, say, well, most patients don't have 10%. They might only have 3 or 4%, in which case the interference is insignificant. But if the hemoglobin F is above 10%, you must consider it and correct. And we also looked at hemoglobin C, E, S, and D traits. And generally, of all of the common methods, enzymatic, the new BI-RADS ion exchange methods and so on, they're very resistant to low levels of these hemoglobinopathies. They've been designed to not be reacted by them. The full-blown thalassemia major, of course, they're going to be connected. But again, you have to ask, why would that happen? Well, here is the Abbott enzymatic assay for hemoglobin C and S. And you can see there's very little interference in modern methods from the hemoglobinopathies. And another article saying that hemoglobin variants S, C, D, E, and E do not interfere with the enzymatic assay, but hemoglobin F above 10% interferes with the assay. Now, another issue which people cross, say the unreliability of hemoglobin A1C, is that in iron deficiency, hemoglobin A1C may be unreliable. And rather than in iron deficiency, so when you're iron deficient, your hemoglobin A1C might be 5.4, and when you're not iron deficient, it's 5.3. So that's statistically significant, but clinically insignificant. 0.1% of a shift in hemoglobin A1C is smaller than your analytical variation. So this is something to consider. Now, why is hemoglobin A1C higher in iron deficiency? Because in iron deficiency, the red cells have to live longer. They're so precious that you've made one with a bit of iron, you don't want to destroy it in 90 days. You want to keep it for 120 days. And that means it's got a greater chance to accumulate glucose, and the A1C is a little bit higher, not a lot. And we've known that for, again, many years, that the mean red blood cell age, if the cells age longer, your hemoglobin A1C might be a bit higher. If the cells are destroyed faster, then the hemoglobin A1C will be lower. And this is much more significant today than the hemoglobinopathies, the estimation of red cell turnover. Because once red cell turnover falls below the usual range, the hemoglobin A1C can drop very dramatically. So patients with very fast red cell turnover, hemolytic anemia, hypersplenism, they have misleading hemoglobin A1C. Now in my laboratory, there's a simple rule. If you're anemic, you probably have very poor red cell turnover, so don't trust the hemoglobin A1C. But if your hemoglobin is normal, you'll probably be keeping up with your red cell losses, and the hemoglobin is far more reliable. Now, hemoglobin A1C we love because it correlates so well with the complications of diabetes. The complications of diabetes include hyperlipidemia and cardiovascular risk, neuropathy, nephropathy, and retinopathy. And in the DCCT trial, we knew that once you got above 8%, the risk of those complications rose exponentially. And that established the use of hemoglobin A1C as a predictor of complications in diabetes. But the questions were, in the early stages, why can't we use it to diagnose diabetes? Because these people down here with hemoglobin A1Cs below about 7 had no risk of complications of diabetes. That means they're not diabetic. And that was in type 1 diabetics, and the UKPDS repeated the same thing for type 2 diabetics. And in type 2 diabetics, once you drop below about 6 or 7, the risks of complications were minimal. In other words, you probably didn't have diabetes. But the problem was, even though we knew that at the turn of the century, that our methods weren't good enough. 7% in one lab could be 9% in another lab. And so people said, we can't say 7% is normal because lab have different numbers. And so so this is how variable hemoglobin A1Cs were in the CAP surveys until 2008, when people pushed for standardisation of hemoglobin A1C. And after the IFCC standardisation was introduced, then people said, now we can use hemoglobin A1C as a diagnostic tool, and any hemoglobin A1C that's above 6.5% means diabetes, because that's when the risk of complications start to rise. That's when, above 6.5, that's when retinopathy starts to occur. So we could define diabetes using hemoglobin A1C because it correlated with the risks of diabetes and we had a standardised assay. Nevertheless, people didn't trust A1C and they were thinking, well, we're using the glucose tolerance and glucose. How can we use glucose and hemoglobin A1C to diagnose diabetes? And I published many papers 5 or 10 years ago with Susan Manley, who was in the DCCT study, trying to work out an algorithm how we could use glucose and hemoglobin A1C to increase our confidence. But I'm telling you, glucose is rubbish. So all of these algorithms, which I've had a part of, I don't believe in anymore, using glucose and A1C. And so we published a paper with Zhong Lu, my colleague, where we looked at the classification according to GTT and the classification according to hemoglobin A1C. And yes, by the time your hemoglobin A1C is 6.9%, almost all of them are being diagnosed as diabetic by the glucose tolerance test. But what was starting to worry us was, what about here at 6.0? The chance of diabetes was low according to the glucose tolerance test, but the chance of pre-diabetes was quite significant. So why are we only interested in diabetes with hemoglobin A1C? Shouldn't we be interested in how hemoglobin A1C also picks up pre-diabetes? And this is hemoglobin A1C against the prediction of diabetes. So if your hemoglobin A1C is 5%, your chance of diabetes in the next year is zero. Whereas if your hemoglobin A1C is 6%, which is not yet diabetic, your chance of becoming diabetic in the next 1 year is 7.5%. So 1 in 10 patients or more will have diabetes in 1 year. And the A1C is telling us that. And this is such an important paper by Selvin and co. Because what they looked at was the risk of cardiovascular disease. Not retinopathy or nephropathy, cardiovascular disease. And you can see when the hemoglobin A1C is 6.5% here, where you're diabetic, cardiovascular disease rises way before that at about 5.5%. So I have to agree with previous speakers that cholesterol is not as important in my mind as hemoglobin A1C. Particularly in populations that have got obesity and diabetes. So hemoglobin A1C not only correlates against cardiovascular disease, but the risk of dying from any cause, including stroke, rises at 5.5%. And when you look at the individual components of the pre-diabetic metabolic syndrome, which is we recognise as the deadly quartet that causes cardiovascular disease, all of those parameters, whether it be hypertension, hypertriglyceridemia, or low HDL, they don't occur at 6.5, they occur at from 5.5%. So A1C can be used, and I think it will be used, to define metabolic syndrome. In America, they use 5.7 and above as an impaired A1C, a pre-diabetic state. In New Zealand, they also use a hemoglobin A1C of 40 millimoles per mole to define pre-diabetes. Now, is that premature? This is just another Korean study predicting. What happens with insulin? If the metabolic syndrome is hyperinsulinemia, when does insulin start to rise? Insulin starts to rise at hemoglobin A1Cs of 5.5 to 5.9. And if we look at C-peptide, which is an integrator of insulinemia, this is a very interesting graph for those of you interested. When a patient's hyperinsulinemic, it's not when they're diabetic, it's not when they're normal, it's when they're pre-diabetic. So hemoglobin A1C can identify hyperinsulinemia and cardiovascular risk. Now there's one problem though. I'm telling you how important the cutoff for 5.5 is. There's one problem. When we look at laboratories, when they measure 6.5, the 6.5 when you go from one lab to another with a standardised assay might be anywhere between 6.3 and 6.7. But a level of 5.5 with current methods could be anywhere between 5.2 and 6.3. So the problem is our standardisation of assays at levels of 5.5% and our precision at 5.5% isn't good enough to diagnose pre-diabetes. That's why we need assays with CVs of 1% and better calibration at 5.5%. So when we look at pre-diabetes, now this is pre-diabetes in India. Remember, diabetes was 67 million. This is pre-diabetics. And India is the world leader for pre-diabetics. We've beaten the Americans here. And in 20 years' time, we'll move even further ahead in terms of pre-diabetes. That's not something to be proud of, by the way. And when we look at diabetes, if we don't do anything, the prevalence of diabetes will go from 69 million to 100. There'll be twice as many diabetics in the year 2040. You still won't overtake China as the most diabetics. They're growing their diabetics very quickly as well. But this is what we want to prevent. And what I'm saying to you is we need good hemoglobin A1Cs to pick up pre-diabetes so we can prevent the progression to diabetes. So in India, the issues with hemoglobin A1C measurements are the population is aging. These are the reasons why we should do hemoglobin A1C testing, the best test for diabetes and pre-diabetes. The population.
What is your opinion about point of care testing in HP?
Okay. Now, I think point of care testing, because it has high variability, is very useful in the situations, not when you're trying to work out whether control is good or fair, but when you're trying to work out whether control is good or very bad. So we use it in adolescent clinics where they have very poor diabetic control because we can get a result straight away. But we're not trying to distinguish 7% from 8%. We're trying to distinguish 7% from 9% or 10%. And therefore, we can afford to have a CV of 3 or 4% rather than 1 or 2%. So depending on the circumstance, you can use it. But in terms of diagnosing diabetes or pre-diabetes, I don't think the assays are, most of the point of care assays aren't there yet. But the new point of care assays are. There are some electrochemical assays of hemoglobin A1C which do have CVs of 1 or 2%. And I'd be very happy to use those in every clinic. But yeah, so if you've got a point of care assay with a CV of 3 or 4%, you can still use them, but in a different way to the laboratory hemoglobin A1C.
Sir, with the wide research, are there any established norms regarding using HbA1c in pregnancy?
Another reason. Now, I'm telling you, in my laboratory, if somebody has a hemoglobin A1C of 5.3%, I guarantee you they won't be gestational diabetic. If they have a hemoglobin A1C of 5.8%, I guarantee you they'll be gestational diabetic. But 5.3 and 5.8, that's a big gap. Many women are in that gap. So what we really need in pregnancy is to close the gap. And what we need for that is assays with a CV of 1%, because most of that variation is analytical. So if we can improve our hemoglobin A1C assays, I think it will be used for diagnosing diabetes in first trimester and in second trimester. In the third trimester, you cannot use hemoglobin A1C, because the mother in the third trimester is making lots of blood. The baby's growing, it needs oxygen. She's making blood because she knows she might lose some when childbirth. So she's making lots of new blood, and hemoglobin A1C falls naturally in the third trimester. But in a way, we don't want to wait for the third trimester anyway. We're only interested in the first and second trimester. Now, one last thing with hemoglobin A1C, people say, oh, well, maybe we can't use it in the third trimester, but maybe we can use it after the pregnancy's finished. The woman comes back at 6 weeks postpartum. She's not pregnant anymore. No, you can't use it at 6 weeks. The cells she has at 6 weeks were the ones that she made during pregnancy and in response to the blood loss of pregnancy. So you can use hemoglobin A1C after pregnancy, but you must wait 3 months.
So does it mean the 75 gram glucose post glucose test, whether it should be oscillated in the first and second trimester, or should we?
Look, at the moment it's the guideline to use that test, because there's many investigators around the world who are trying to replace it with the hemoglobin A1C test. So at the moment the guideline is to use the glucose tolerance test. But I'm telling you, I'd like to come back in 3 or 4 years, and I expect the guideline will be based on hemoglobin A1C, and we'll be saving all of those pregnant mothers that horrible drink, which so many of them vomit up. We have to be kind to these women.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. At the onset, I would like to thank Roche and the organizers for having me here. It has indeed been 2 days of good academic sessions, and I hope I may live up to that standard. This is the point. My talk today is on the testing methods and standardization of thyroid hormones. As you have seen, whenever we speak about clinical chemistry and the lab, we always speak on the same threads of how difficult it is to have standardized these tests and how difficult it is to understand what we mean by harmonization, especially in our country. Now, most of the standardization and harmonization is based on the studies brought out by the International Federation of Clinical Chemistry, and they have done this in various areas of looking at thyroid hormones, and that is the Committee for Task Force for Standardization of Thyroid Hormones. And it is the standard now that is being widely accepted. This study was done in 2010. And it is what is being adapted even by companies all over the globe. And this was studied in three phases. The phases were where they looked at TSH, then they looked at FT3, FT4, and then they looked at T3, T4. The other study that has come in correlation with them is the Association of the American Clinical Chemistry and the NACB. Now, most of our findings and what the companies speak of nowadays is dependent on these studies, and this is what I will be touching. Now, we all know the incidence of the various problems we have, and every laboratory looks at these types of thyroid problems. But what we fail as laboratory physicians is that we never ask for the history. Most of the time, the samples that come to us are samples. We fail to look at the sample as a patient. We think that is the duty of the clinician. And that is where we go wrong many a time. Every sample that arrives should have a history. The history is so important, and so is the age and sex when the variables are so plenty. So this is what has been published earlier, that we have 15% of endemic goiter, followed by hyperthyroidism, thyroiditis, hyperthyroidism, Graves' disease, and cancer. This may not be necessarily true in our country, and we are so diverse in our populations across the country that this is a Western publication and therefore does not hold true. We see a lot of hypothyroidisms and plenty of subclinical hypothyroidisms, which we diagnose sometimes very late. Now, this is also a illustration of the incidence all over the world. And you will see at the bottom right, India. And India at that time, this study was done in the east zone of India and definitely does not represent the whole of India. And that is where we are lacking. If you have heard the previous speaker, all of them, whatever changes or ranges are brought into their own respective countries are through a consensus of their national associations. We fail miserably in this aspect. And we have just sporadic studies which come out from labs, and it is published as though it is an Indian representation. This is where we fail. This particular measurement, which has been expressed there as India, is a publication done in 2010. And we know that none of us, or most of us, do not represent the range as 7 today. All the ranges across the country, 40 SH, are well within 5 or little over 5. So when we have associations, or we have a large number of labs under one banner, it is better we do it in different parts of the country and represent to the world what our population or our reference range is. And that is what I'm going to go into a little further this afternoon. Now, different patterns of thyroid function and tests, I don't have to go into this in detail because all of you know. But the slide has been done because it is from an endocrinology source. And this endocrinology source, where the authors of this paper have shown distinctly that the same common tests which we talk about in a daily way are tests that represent various aspects of various disorders. We sometimes do only TSH and think that free T4 is not necessary in a lab. And we know that our population shops from lab to lab and from doctor to doctor. As in any clinical chemistry resources of the lab, we have variables of standardization, we have variables of traceability, and therefore the patient is the one who is in a dire position, and so is the clinician. Now, these simple 4 tests have to be thoroughly understood. And speaking from my own experience in the laboratory of so many years, the problem with us, especially both the seniors and the juniors, is we do not read the kit insert in totality. If we read the material that is provided by the company in totality, our view, our interpretation of this test would be entirely different. We buy the instruments because the company has approached us. It is a reagent rental. It looks feasible for us to pay, but actually the company is making more money than we make when they give it on reagent rental. And we do not know what the source, what the traceability of this is. Some other big hospital or small hospital, your peer group, has that instrument in your own town, and therefore I should get it. This is where we fail. And this is where we fail internationally. The previous lecture shows you in what depth they work in their laboratories. In clinical chemistry, that same depth is not found across all the labs in the country. At least in a certain sense, thanks to the accreditation body and Government of India, we have many things falling into line. When we started our careers, we never bothered about what is traceability, what is reference range, and many other aspects that we are actually looking at nowadays. But this is what makes us different from our other countries' clinical chemistry labs. So my intention of going into this lecture is with this view. For all the junior colleagues who are starting out their careers as laboratory physicians, history is of utmost importance. It is not a sample that you are treating, it is a patient. If collectively all of us can say the sample will not be accepted without history, I think in a few years' time we will have fantastic publications. Now the second thing is, do we understand what we are doing? We don't understand what we are doing many a time. The company comes and loads the machine onto your table in the lab. First day everybody is around it, senior doctors, junior doctors, and from day one it is with the technician. The maintenance of the machines are so important. They are carryovers for so many chemistries, especially even for T3, T4, TSS. And this is how we have to start looking at our lab work. Now, these are the same tests, and interpretation is never with the lab. The lab thinks its duty is over when it releases the numericals. We never try to correlate. We are giving a free T3 that is high. What is the TSH? Many a time, we know that the TSH comes in with T3, T4 on day one, goes to the clinician, the patient comes back after 7 days to us with only a request of free T4. Neither the clinician writes the values, neither we ask the patient what has happened, and we are releasing another numerical which we don't know anything about. So this is not the way to work. This is why we are failing even in interpreting many of our thyroid problems. Now, one of the most important things that we have, and we have to look at, whatever be the platform that we are using, is the reference ranges. Like I mentioned in the second slide, that reference range as quoted from India is 7. And I'm sure at least 99% of people sitting in this room do not give a 7 as a normal for TSH nowadays. Now the reference interval is defined here as the interval between and including two numbers, an upper and lower reference limit, which are estimated to enclose a specified percentage. Now when we buy a kit, we have to see what percentile of that the company is referring to. There are claims that 99 percentile is good. There are claims that 95 percentile is good. There may be many reasons for what the companies say, but are we, as signing authorities, actually understood what this 95 or 99 percentile is? We are just taking what the kit insert says or what literature says. Now, what needs to be done? This is one of the fundamental things that we can start with when we choose to report our values. Reference ranges may differ from the expected value stated in the method sheet. And it is for this reasons that we have to make our own normals, either as a country, either as a region, either as a zone. Somewhere we have to start. Otherwise, we are going to get discrepancies all the time. And these reference values, as mentioned by the previous speaker, are gender dependent, are age dependent, are when an individual is pregnant, and the geographical differences, and especially us who have such varied ethnicity. Therefore, what is the fundamental thing that we have to look at? We have to look at, to investigate the transferability of the expected value to its own patient population. We have a lot of publications from India, but all of them are from individual labs. They are not on a consensus statement of a body. The government also will not take into heed any change or gazetted notification of any diseases and its reference values if there is no consensus statement. It will not take into a hold saying that this should be the reference range for this parameter as stated by this lab. So my feeling and my passion is that whatever body one may belong to, let us put all our work into one consensus statement. And when that will come is when we will have publications like how the previous speaker so authentically has spoken about the ways the Australian system works. The Australian system and its Academy of Clinical Biochemists is so strong. Whatever that body says, the government follows. If the government says, if they say creatinine has to be calibrated with an IDMS calibrator, it is done. It becomes a law. So that sort of a thing is what we should also look for. Machines are abundant. Vendors are abundant. Choice of both of them is ours. But how are we going to translate it into patient care is our responsibility. What needs to be considered? Carefully choose the population. We have not done this for any parameter. We have not done this even for simple glucose. Select carefully the inclusion and exclusion criteria. We write SOPs and we write a lot of things about inclusion, exclusion criteria. But do we follow it? No. To compute the reference interval for the 95th central percentile with 90, 95, 99, we have to measure and study these numerical number of samples. Yes, it is a tough task. It cannot be done by small labs, by individuals. It has to be a consensus statement. My request to the companies is, you choose Z areas, you choose zones, try to bring them all together onto the same platform and then arrive at an Indian reference. We all get pediatric cases for TSH. How many of us can genuinely say this is the reference range for this neonatal TSH? We do not have. We take it from so many publications. That is the best we can do. At least we do that, I agree. But Canada has one. The English reference is different. The Australian reference is different. The kit reference is different because they are CE stamped. Most of these come from either US FDA approved or CE approved. Their references are different. So when we are dealing with pediatric samples, this problem is more complex. Roche follows the international CLS, IFCC, and so do the others. Since I'm speaking on Roche's invitation, this line has been put. I'm not supporting any company. The central 95% interval is that acceptance or rejection? Both, okay. The central 95% interval is defined as the 2.5 and 97.5 percentile. Out of 200 cases, I don't use Roche, by the way. Out of 200 cases, five results will be below and five results will be above. And this is how it is going to look like. Now, this is what is supposed to be the interval that we have to accept. How many of us have actually looked at such things? We have never looked at such things. And you know the variety of platforms that we deal with in daily life. So it is impossible for us to have a consensus unless a study is done with cooperation of everybody across the board, the vendors, the so-called financial managements of the centers we work in, and we as individuals who work in the lab. And they feel that the 95 percentile is the best. But there are lots of big major companies which we are operating nowadays which give you the 99 percentile. So the difference in variation of the reference range itself starts from here. So what is the consensus? Each company can claim their own consensus because they know it will be bought. But the idea is we have to start thinking, and it is not too late to think what the future should do. Now this is an example of the various percentiles that you have with their reference ranges. This self is itself a picture of how we report. And FT3 and FT4 are something we are using in abundance nowadays, because we are not able to justify the TSH values we get. Subclinical hypothyroidism is not being taken up or seen at an early phase. And therefore, if we do not understand what all we are doing, we will not be able to talk to the clinician with authority. Now look at these values of FT3, FT4. It is with these reasons that IFCC took up the responsibility of bringing in standardization. It was very, very difficult to standardize a TSH source, even as today. So the best thing that they have done, they have tried to harmonize different company platforms to bring in a statement. They have worked with 18 companies. They have been successful in FT3 and FT4 standardization. At the first instance, they have tried some 14 labs, out of which 9 for FT3 and the rest for FT4. They failed, but they recalibrated, did many modifications, and now they have successfully standardized a reference where all vendors have to look at that reference like how it is for IDMS creatinine, and therefore they have been able to successfully do for FT3 and FT4. But TSH is still a problem. The closest they have got is trying to harmonize platforms for TSH. Variable percentiles are used for different parameters by manufacturers, and therefore it is a major problem when we write our reference intervals. Now TSH method variability across manufacturers is up to 20%. So that means from one lab to another, the variation of an individual's TSH can be so high. Different vendors are participating in an IFCC working group on standardization of thyroid functions, which has the goal to achieve an improved comparability between different methods on the market. And this is what they have successfully strived. You can read all these three standardizations they have attempted in the clinical chemistry issue of 2010, and the 2015 one brings out a statement along with AACC that they have successfully been able to standardize T3 and T4, but TSH, the best they can do is only harmonize. Phase 4 of the study is ongoing, and its results are expected to be published by this year. The decision for applicability to all vendor methods will be taken thereafter. So obviously, since IFCC is a very strong consensus body, it has the liberty and the authority to force vendors into using the same standardization for uniformity across the globe. Now, why do these differences arise? And we have never wondered why. They are different antibodies recognizing different parts of the molecule. I don't know how many of you belong to a generation that is about my generation, where we did all this on ELISA. And it was explained in the morning how ELISA procedures can be so different in that Mullerian study that was presented. And we also had these problems, but now hardly anybody does these tests by ELISA. We are doing it on automated machines, well-standardized, robust methodologies. Usage of different labels or epitopes. We have no idea what the calibration epitopes are, where the source is, what the traceability is. Differences in reagent specificity, differences in traceability, differences in calibration, and the glycosylation patterns which the TSH molecule has. There are so many forms of it, so that is what is the major pitfall for this to succeed at the moment. Now, when you get into to the program of trying to get a reference range, local population, what are the inclusion criteria, number of subjects, and what are the percentiles used? And now this is what all companies should strive to come forward, follow the IFCC guidelines, and bring uniformity into India. Now, when they have looked at, this is a publication, when they have looked at various companies, they have found that Advia and Cobas are closest to each other. Whereas other companies, like as mentioned in the slide, are highly variable. But then what do? The least we can do is we can learn to harmonize, draw a concordance graph, use a fraction like they have used. So these are implications that we have to look at. We have bought an instrument, we have found that there is a variability, then that means we have to do concordance studies. We never do concordance studies. Your neighbor will have another platform. You can have interlaboratory comparison, do a concordance study, and try to arrive at the closest or to the nearest the both the labs would give. Now, this is the same thing showing that one company has a high variability compared to Roche and Cobas. Now, what is the other reason? The other reason it could be because whether they use the one-step assays or whether they use the two-step assays. Now, it is proven that one-step assays are prone to interference by T3, T4. Companies claim that the procedures that they have two-step assays is not a problem, but both the types of assays have the same problem. And therefore, we have to look at various things that will tell us which is near to accuracy about the IFCC calibration or the accepted traceability as of today. And whether you have a two-step or whether you have a one-step, how is it that your reports are going to represent in as a numerical? If you have a two-step, it is taught and it has been found, higher signals and you get a lower concentration. Whereas those that have lower signals, they have higher concentration. So this is graphically representing that if we have not understood our procedure, the variability of TSH between two platforms is highly variable. Now, if you look at FT4 and autoantibodies are removed, there is a higher signal, and then similarly, there is a lower signal. Now, what we don't look at is that autoantibodies or heterophil antibodies are very, very high. In most of our immunoassays, these type of antibodies are very common, and they are more prominent in thyroglobulin and thyroid hormones. And we have never really understood this. And we do not have the various methodologies to remove this. In Western countries, if the labs have this, they tend to remove it. There are specific tubes, etc. But those type of things are not marketed so easily in India. Now these heterophil antibodies can give various wrong numericals to us because there is a lot of interference. And this is seen especially when you do the antibody studies for thyroid or the thyroglobulin that we do, and many of these tests that we do. These heterophil antibodies are autoantibodies, and they can cause a lot of numerical variables. And all they say is dilute. Now, this is another issue that companies are not honest with us. each company has a specific diluent. I agree the diluent may be normal saline, but they will never tell you what the diluent is. If you ask them 1,000 times, why is this happening? You have not used our diluent. They have a diluent for TSH, they have a diluent for NT-proBNP, they have a diluent for vitamin D. It is not possible for us. The nearest thing that we can do, and the cheapest that we can do, we use saline. There are some labs which you use water. So we have not really studied this. So the companies don't disclose, but I am sure all that is there is only saline, but they market it with a lot of cost. And we have no choice. When we are in a soup, okay, you give us the diluent. When you buy one diluent, you cannot use that diluent, believe me, for another parameter. That other parameter, you have to buy another diluent. Yes or no?
Yes.
So these are things only we, when we understand how we work, can tell the company, and when all of us in one voice tell the company, then I think things will work out. Now when these happen, the measurements are all incorrect. Now these are the various principles of the test, as I showed in the previous slide. Some claim that a two-step will not have variants because of autoantibodies. One company claims ours is the best because we do not wash. The other company claims we wash. The company which says that company washes, it loses all its free T4. So there are various stories if you talk to companies. So when we buy a machine, let's do our homework properly. The company is not going to do homework for us. We have to do the homework. And one of the easiest ways, what is that hospital using? Who is using? Who else is using? And that is how we choose our machines. We never read the literature before we choose our machines. And I think a day has come. Those literatures that are supplied by the company, they will supply to you even before you buy the machine. You have all the right to ask. Please read the material. And the disadvantage is, these are closed systems. You cannot buy different systems, one for vitamin D, one for B12, one for folate. So whatever machine we buy, we have to do all the tests on that. Is this a disadvantage or not? Yes. So I think these are facts of life that we have to seriously take and move forward. Now this is something we all know, but for completion's sake I have to do it. Sample handling and storage, biological variations, interferences, and different glycosylation patterns of the TSH molecule, which gives probably the variabilities among the labs when we do not standardize or harmonize, or we are not able to show a traceability. The typical sampling handling errors are, as we understand it, of other things. If you are expected to keep it in minus 20, you please keep it in minus 20. Several freeze and thaw cycles will spoil the sample. Mixing up of samples, identification, this goes with any process in the lab. Now, this is something I am worried, because when we started our careers, late 80s and early 90s, we were taught, even as MD students, take fasting TSH samples. But now nobody takes fasting samples. Why? The reagents are so good, nothing will happen. Up to bilirubin this level, up to lipids this level, up to that. But if you actually take your own sample from 5 in the morning till 6 in the evening, you will find changes of TSH. The changes may be minute, but this is a legal world. Literature states that the maximum changes will occur in the night, from 12 to say 6 or 8 in the morning. And the changes that happen between 8 and 4 in the evening are not highly considerable. But if you study certain samples, from 7 to 9 to 11 to 12, if the readings are seen, you cannot explain anything to the patient. They will ask you, if you knew this, why didn't you tell me what time was the best to give my sample? So we have a lot of inherent problems. When we were 20 years back doing fasting samples, I think Dr. Tapadia, we were doing fasting samples earlier on. Only fasting. It was a criteria. We were taught you should take thyroid sampling should be on fasting. But somewhere along the line, this got lost because we are so robust in our reagents and instrumentation. But there are these variables. Variables between 9 and 4 o'clock may not be so high significantly in numbers of numericals. But to a patient, he has given in one lab at 8 o'clock, he has given in another lab at 12 o'clock, he has given in another lab at 4 o'clock, and the endocrinologist and the clinician will tell you, no problem, you take it. They don't want to lose their patient. We don't want to lose our income to the lab, so we take it. But these are points that should be taught about, and I think we should come to some decision what time is best for your own lab, for your own population, and whether we should actually go back to a fasting state in the sense that the time you take it is usually between 8 and 9. So these are small things, but with experience you see so many pitfalls that we cannot correct. We know they exist, but we cannot correct it. Now these are some types of molecules that we say cause of macro TSH are endogenous autoantibodies to TSH. And this complex, the heterophil antibody, is biologically inactive as it cannot bind to the TSH receptor. So when we get very high values, we dilute. To what extent will you dilute? Is it necessary to dilute? 5 times, 10 times. And junior doctors will tell you, no, we want exact figure. In a case of TSH, yes, in my own personal experience in the lab, I can say yes, if he has 500 and you dilute and you give a 500 value, next month after treatment, if it's 250 or 300, that is an improvement. But till what extent can we dilute? And till what extent should we dilute? Sometimes you see TSH is 1800. Somewhere in the dilution, there is an error. But what is that error? We are not able to pinpoint on the figure. So these are things I think each of us in our own labs have to look at these problems, because companies are not going to look at it for you. And these are the variations of the glycosylation of a TSH molecule, which is endogenous in the molecule itself, and therefore the standardization is very, very difficult. IFCC has made so many efforts, and as of today, it is very difficult to standardize TSH. They have successfully, with repeated comparable methods, have succeeded in standardizing free T3, T4, T4, T3. But TSH, they have not been able to standardize. And therefore, the best way at the moment, what they could do, is to harmonize. And that is what is told to the vendors throughout the world. So how to deal with differences? You run it on another machine, which is more problematic. You send it to another lab. So there are different ways, but I think as laboratory physicians, we should know best how to deal with each individual sample. Now this is the streamlined cascade of testing, which I'm sure all of you know, so we won't go into that. And these are the variables. Now this is a slide which has come from the UK EQUAS, which shows how close or different the various companies are. There's Abbott, there's Advia, there's Beckman, there's Access, and the Beckman Access, and now you have the big Beckman Modular, and you have Roche. Now why I am showing this slide is, we also do EQUAS. And most of us, 90% of us must be doing it with Bio-Rad, and the remaining must be doing it with Randox. we are not able to produce an illustrative graph like this from BioRad. They will tell you peer group. They will tell you Z-score. You ask them, you give me a representative graph of the labs in India. They will tell you performance. Performance, 100% labs are very good. Some 2% are bad. 3% are best. These are the reports that come to us. But they never come like this for our Indian labs. And I think they have more than 300, 400 labs registered with them. Randox has few. RCPA has chemistry, but none of the Indian labs, as far as I know, maybe two or three exceptions, do immunoassay with them. So from a representative EQUAS program, you can make out the variables. And we should demand of BioRad or Randox, wherever we do our EQUAS, to give us a representative graph like this to show where our Indian labs stand. There's no use looking at UK EQUAS. It doesn't serve any purpose. Okay, I won't go into this because you're... Spontaneous evolution of hyperthyroid Graves' disease to hyperthyroidism has been detected in long-term follow-ups of cohorts, 10 to 15 years, and occurs in that percentage of patients treated with these drugs. There may be many mechanisms. So when we are talking about this, the next aspect is to talk about thyroid antibodies. When a patient or an endocrinologist asks for thyroid antibodies, we will have 1,000 calls from the patient, from the junior. What all do we send for thyroid antibodies? Should we send thyroglobulin? Should we send receptor? Should we send this? Should we send that? There is no particular guideline from the companies that you can do this. They have isolatedly put this. But we are supposed to do at least 2-3 tests of the antibodies to overcome and understand this situation. Now this is a representative slide from what I said of IFCC. This was before they could harmonize. This is the picture on the left shows the variable TS results. But once they have tried to harmonize 18 platforms, they have tried to harmonize 18 platforms, the TSHs are more or less close to each other. Now the harmonizing steps that we follow in our labs for accreditation is this is how we do it. We have to get a measurement, a reference material that is available, that is WHO, and then we do the procedures, do the master calibrations, and arrive at how close we are nearest to the mean dated. Now the next challenge is the pediatric challenge. The pediatric challenge is very, very difficult because we don't have guidelines. Laboratory references are very, very difficult. Do free thyroid hormones play a major role in pediatric samples? And this is how their Canadian references, their Mayo Clinic references, their Australian references, their US references, and the values are so variable. So we should try to have our own pediatric references. Till then, we follow what we think is good in literature. And this is, And this is a small study. We are twin cities in Hyderabad, Secunderabad and Hyderabad. We have a small association of labs in the twin cities. And from 2006 to 2014, we have done 27 different sample cycles. And this is how we are. There is so much of variability between the platforms that we ourselves use. So if we in a small city can have so much of variables, imagine what it would be in our whole country. All of these are chemiluminescence in modified versions, except Minividas in the last column. And you will see that, you will see the variability of the TSHs among ourselves, T3, T4, in our own platforms, in a small city of some 14 labs. So that is where we stand, and we have to do an introspection of ourselves in how we report thyroiditis. Thank you very much.
thank you all for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be here, to be present. It's my first time in India as well, and I'm very happy to share some of the information that I have available. I would also like to thank the previous speaker for doing a great service in actually introducing the topic of thyroid function testing, because it saves me a lot of time and so I can get on with some of the differences. And I really want to focus a little bit more on the particular area of thyroid dysfunction, which is around Graves' disease testing. So just a disclaimer, I'm an employee of Siemens, so you can be very, very sure that I will not be speaking on behalf of Abbott or Roche. So I won't go through much detail on this slide, but I think everyone in this audience will be very familiar of the TRH, TSH, T4 feedback loop, okay, from the hypothalamus, pituitary, and going on. The important thing here that I would also like to elucidate here is that actually when you look at the thyroid hormone synthesis and where you have anti-TPO or anti-TG or TREP, where this autoantibody actually persist are actually targets of the various components for hormone synthesis and regulation. For example, here, thyroid peroxidase being the one that would incorporate iodine, and of course the TREP TSH receptor autoantibody here, that is the one that links the connectivity to the thyrocyte cells. I won't go through too much detail, except that, you know, as all of you know, thyroid disease is an global epidemic. About 5% approximately will experience a thyroid problem at some stage of life. The important thing is when epidemiological studies have been done across the world, you can see that the numbers are quite different, as this previous speaker had already mentioned. But I did manage to get one from an epidemiological study from India that I thought was quite representative of the various urbanized cities. And of course, these were all performed on Siemens platform. But one of the things that really can be very highlighted here is the fact that you do have quite a significant percentage of folks that are actually hypothyroid or hyperthyroid. And the last thing as well is on the anti-TPO positivity, and I'll touch a little bit about the significance of this as well. As you know, thyroid is also likely to disproportionately affect the women, but importantly as well when it comes to hyper or hypo, excuse me, you can see that in terms of hypo, it is very much age dependent. But when it comes to the hazard ratio for hyperthyroidism, this actually can persist as early as 20 to 40 years old in the case of Graves' disease. Now, thyroid autoimmunity is now the number one cause of thyroid disease in the developed world, or places where it's iodine sufficient. Of course, where there is iodine deficiency, then of course it will be a little bit of a different picture. But the important thing here is it is thought that the cause for thyroid autoimmunity is stated here, where there is a little bit of a genetic predisposition based on your population, in which there is some activation of the autoimmune process. And the first thing that really comes up is that of your autoantibodies, follow which, of course, your TSH would that have this elevation or depression, following which, of course, finally, your free T4 and free T3s are affected. And generally, when it comes to autoimmune thyroid disease, there are two main ones, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, that will cause hypothyroidism, as well as Graves' disease that will cause hyper. And these are the common autoantibodies on the left here, which are being used to assess and make a diagnosis for these kinds of diseases. Graves' disease is actually, Graves, the name, actually comes from this quite handsome Irish clinician here, who actually discovered the disease in about the 19th century. Quite similarly, in the Europe side, in Germany, there is another physician by the name of Bazardoff, who've actually discovered the same disease. And so in some publications, you may see grace for most of the English-speaking population, but in some European journals, you will see that it's also being called Buzzardorf's disease. And as I mentioned to you, with autoimmune thyroid disease being very prominent, it now accounts for anything between 60% to 90% of all hyperthyroid cases. And the age of onset, as I mentioned, can be as early as 20 years old. Now, when it comes to GD, you usually have a classical triad of symptoms, ranging, of course, predominantly with hyperthyroid symptoms. These are very general and non-specific, as I will share later. But quite a significant proportion of them will actually develop orbitopathy, and some of the more rare cases would actually include skin disorders. Now, I won't go through this too much here, because I think everyone's very familiar with the classic serology for hyperthyroidism and for subclinical hyperthyroidism. But the important thing when it comes to hyperthyroidism is that it is not really that easy to make a diagnosis, because you can see the symptoms are actually very non-specific. Anything from tachycardia or palpitations to tremors, to being nervous. So, currently I'm quite nervous on stage. Does it mean I have hyperthyroidism? And more importantly as well, you do get some very, very different kinds of symptoms that may not always be associated with hyperthyroid patients as well. Now, this is the general approximation of the percentages of presence of autoantibodies depending on which group of population. And you can see in general for autoimmune diseases, anti-TPO has emerged as quite a fairly good indicator or screen for autoimmune thyroid disease in general. And it should be able to pick up most of the Hashimoto's thyroiditis cases as outlined in the second group. But when it comes to Graves' disease, it's not very specific, and that's why the TRAP and TSIs are actually the ones that have been more specific. There is some debate in the publications on whether or not there is really usefulness for anti-TG, since anti-TPO is so widely used. This really is up to the lab's discretion. We do see some cases where you do have anti-TG positive and anti-TPO negative, but I guess when you are looking through your records, you can decide and make a decision on how much of it will actually, how useful your anti-TG will actually be in differential diagnosis of autoimmune-related thyroid diseases. I did mention about the complications of Graves' disease. So this is one of the classic symptoms of Graves' disease, where the interesting thing is actually that the antibodies of the TSH receptor also target some of the retroorbital tissues, so some of the tissues behind your eyes. And this is also the reason why it causes the inflammation leading to protruding eyes, as you can see there. It's quite also interesting that this has a very strong association with tobacco, and these are some of the other signs that you'll see. The other serious complications of Graves' disease is, because this is of an autoantibody origin, you do get an additional complexity when you see patients who are actually women who are actually pregnant. As you know, most of the maternal antibodies will be able to transfer to that of the fetus. And that's why it's very important as well to have good monitoring of both mother and newborn, and also to control any thyroid dysfunction in the fetus as well, and the neonate. So I go into a little bit more specific detail into the TSH receptor, and by far and large it is consisting of two, the beta subunit and the alpha subunit. And the beta subunit is part of a greater hormone receptor family that also includes LH, FSH, etc. And this receptor is usually embedded into the thyrocyte, and this is where, of course, you have two kinds of epitopes that are subjected, the stimulatory kind as well as the inhibitory or blocking kind. Now, TSH autoantibodies are those that are that would actually competitively bind to the TSH receptor. So in the normal case where you have your TSH that binds to the TSH receptor to produce your T4 and T3, you actually do get different kinds of autoantibodies. So the one that actually causes Graves' disease is the one that is actually known as the TSI, or thyroid stimulatory immunoglobulin, or TSAB in some cases. You have ones that are inhibitory or blocking, so either TBII or TBAB, which actually have an inverse effect when it binds to the TSH receptor, as I will share later. There is a third kind, which is a kind of antibody that binds, that it really doesn't really do much. We still don't know what is the significance of a neutral autoantibody, so I'll not be covering in this part of my lecture. But it's important to note that for stimulatory, of course, it will actually activate the TSH receptor to actually produce more T4 and T3 as well. So in the case of the effect of a TSI, it will actually competitively bind to the TSH receptor, leading to an overproduction of T4 and T3. And as a result, you do get your general serological hyperthyroid case in this case. The blocking antibody, on the other hand, actually has the reverse, because it also will competitively bind to the TSH receptor. But in the case, because it is an inhibitory kind of antibody, what happens then is you have a underproduction of your T4 or T3 hormones, in which, of course, based on the feedback, you will actually get an excess of TSH and T3 and T4. And this is also one of the reasons for the confounding factors if you are using TRAP assays to make a diagnosis on Graves' disease. So just to do a very quick review of all the nomenclatures that I've mentioned, because I've... So first, of course, is TRAP. TRAP is also known as TSH receptor autoantibody, and actually, if you look at the nomenclature itself, it will actually mean those that actually are stimulatory in nature and inhibitory in nature. Then you have ones that are TBAB, in which these are the blocking kind or the inhibitory kind, and of course ones that are the stimulatory kind. So if you are looking at the literature or looking at publications, please do take note of some of these nomenclature that are being used. In terms of the assay type as well, the assays will actually detect different kinds of autoantibodies. So in the case of the previous speaker who mentioned about TRAP assays, these assays are actually assays that will detect both the blocking and the stimulatory autoantibody. There are some that also call anti-TSHR, which actually essentially does the same. And of course, TBII. These are some that are they could also be ELISA-based, and they also do detect both kinds of antibodies. Only when you have a TSI, which have different technologies, as I'll mention later, these are the ones that will only detect the stimulatory kind, and it is the one that is specific and sensitive for Graves' disease assessment. So in the classic case of hyperthyroidism, or where you have T3 toxicosis, the addition of TSI or TRAP could actually be the differential in making an assessment on the patient itself. So before I go on into about assay evolution and some of the updates on Graves' disease, I just also want to share a little bit about the clinical practice patterns that you see worldwide. And this is actually quite an interesting study, because it actually shows a difference between the clinical practice patterns from our US endocrinologists versus those of our European counterparts. And you can see that the way that they use the different kinds of technology available to make a diagnosis for GD is vastly different. In the US, generally, you would see that they are quite used to your radioactive or isotopic kinds of studies. But in Europe, they are actually more predisposed to using thyroid ultrasounds as well as TRAP, as the TRAP assay, as highlighted in these bars here. So Europe is white and US is dark. I think in most cases in Asia, and at least the countries that I travel, we tend to subscribe a little bit more to the European kind of clinical practice pattern. The interesting thing also on the right side of the diagram is really, if you look at the difference, so this was actually conducted in 2013, and when they reviewed the data from that of 1986, so about 15 years ago, you can see TRAP wasn't very much used then, and currently it is one of the most highly used assays in order to manage Graves' disease. So definitely there must be a very good clinical utility to, and this is also the reason why you see such a great adoption of this particular assay. Now, it also comes to the fact that there are improvements that are being made to assays, and of course, as vendors, it is also our prerogative to make sure that we get the best assays out as possible. And you can see here the different generations of TRAP assays that have been in the market. Generally, they have been improved from the first generation up to the third generation where we are now, where you do get very, very good overall specificity in the 90s range. But a lot of the uptake for TRAP assay has also been because of the fact that it's made available on a lot of automated platforms, and this is also the reason for its adoption. But TSI is mainly previously been restricted a lot to bioassays. So bioassays are a little bit different because they require tissue culture rooms, and they actually require the cultivation of human thyroid cell monolayers, in which it is the patient sample is added to this monolayer, and it will actually measure the bioresponse in response to TSH stimulation, either as a CAMP or luminescent form. So most of the current TRAP assays in the market are actually that of a competitive nature, which means they actually have these kinds of TRAPs in the samples, and they actually use TSH receptors, usually of porcine origin, and they actually intercept the TSH, the endogenous TSH in the sample, so you get a very inverse signal in this case. However, when you look at the value of TSI versus TRAP assays, as I mentioned to you, the cost for GD is a result of the TSI and the stimulatory kind of autoantibody. So rightfully, as you know, it would be, TSI would definitely have a much better accuracy, but it of course suffers from a lack of some issues in terms of its. Thank you all for giving me this wonderful opportunity to be here, to be present. It's my first time in India as well, and I'm very happy to share some of the information that I have available. I would also like to thank the previous speaker for doing a great service in actually introducing the topic of thyroid function testing, because it saves me a lot of time, and so I can get on with some of the differences. And I really want to focus a little bit more on the particular area of thyroid dysfunction, which is around Graves' disease testing. So just a disclaimer, I'm an employee of Siemens, so you can be very, very sure that I will not be speaking on behalf of Abbott or Roche. So I won't go through much detail on this slide, but I think everyone in this audience will be very familiar of the TRH, TSH, T4 feedback loop, okay, from the hypothalamus, pituitary, and going on. The important thing here that I would also like to elucidate here is that actually when you look at the thyroid hormone synthesis, and where you have anti-TPO or anti-TG or TRAP, where this autoantibody actually persist are actually targets of the various components for hormone synthesis and regulation. For example, here, thyroid peroxidase being the one that would incorporate iodine, and of course the TRAP TSH receptor autoantibody here, that is the one that links the connectivity to the thyrocyte cells. I won't go through too much detail, except that, you know, as all of you know, thyroid disease is a global epidemic, about 5% approximately will experience a thyroid problem at some stage of life. The important thing is when epidemiological studies have been done across the world, you can see that the numbers are quite different, as this previous speaker had already mentioned. But I did manage to get one from epidemiological study from India that I thought was quite representative of the various urbanized cities. And of course, these were all performed on Siemens platform. But one of the things that really can be very highlighted here is the fact that you do have quite a significant percentage of folks that are actually hypothyroid or hyperthyroid. And the last thing as well is on the NT-TPO positivity, and I'll touch a little bit about the significance of this as well. As you know, thyroid is also likely to disproportionately affect the women, but importantly as well, when it comes to hyper or hypo, you can see that in terms of hypo, it is very much age dependent. But when it comes to the hazard ratio for hyperthyroidism, this actually can persist as early as 20 to 40 years old in the case of Graves' disease. Now, thyroid autoimmunity is now the number one cause of thyroid disease in the developed world, or places where it's iodine sufficient. Of course, where there is iodine deficiency, then of course it will be a little bit of a different picture. But the important thing here is it is thought that the cause for thyroid autoimmunity is stated here, where there is a little bit of a genetic predisposition based on your population, in which there is some activation of the autoimmune process. And the first thing that really comes up is that of your autoantibodies, follow which, of course, your TSH would that have this elevation or depression, following which, of course, finally, your free T4 and free T3s are affected. And generally, when it comes to autoimmune thyroid disease, there are two main ones, Hashimoto's thyroiditis that will cause hypothyroidism, as well as Graves' disease that will cause hyper. And these are the common autoantibodies on the left here, which are being used to assess and make a diagnosis for these kinds of diseases. Graves' disease is actually, Graves, the name, actually comes from this quite handsome Irish clinician here, who actually discovered the disease in about the 19th century. Quite similarly, in the Europe side, in Germany, there is another physician by the name of Bazardoff, who actually discovered the same disease. And so in some publications, you may see Graves for most of the English-speaking population, but in some European journals, you will see that it's also being called Bazardoff's disease. And as I mentioned to you, with autoimmune thyroid disease being very prominent, it now accounts for anything between 60 to 90% of all hyperthyroid cases. And the age of onset, as I mentioned, can be as early as 20 years old. Now, when it comes to GD, you usually have a classical triad of symptoms, ranging, of course, predominantly with hyperthyroid symptoms. These are very general and non-specific, as I will share later. But quite a significant proportion of them will actually develop orbitopathy, and some of the more rare cases would actually include skin disorders. Now, I won't go through this too much here, because I think everyone's very familiar with the classic serology for hyperthyroidism and for subclinical hyperthyroidism. But the important thing when it comes to hyperthyroidism is that it is not really that easy to make a diagnosis. Yes.
We are trying to interdict your antibody.
Yes.
Sometimes it gives in thousands.
Yes.
Yep. But when it compares with the host system,
yep.
They are looking with the near about 100-115. Mm-hmm. So how can we explain to the patient and clinicians whenever there is a comparison?
So as mentioned from the previous speaker, a lot of times the assays are not standardized. There are internal international standards, and where possible, what vendors try to do is we try our best to match these international standards. But the problem comes is with different assay designs, different monoclonal antibodies, in fact, different kinds of chemiluminescent or electrochemiluminescent kinds of technologies, in which your results may actually be different. The more important thing that I will say when it comes to your autoantibody is actually to look at clinical concordance, which means every assay would actually have a cutoff of whether or not they would be able to tell if it's, in the case of anti-TPO, whether it's Hashimoto's or not. And if the cutoff and the clinical concordance between the different assays, which I would assume would be very, very highly correlative, then there should not be a problem in sharing this with your doctors.
Thank you.
Yep.
Unit is same, but ROS system having the limit, upper limit is 30, near about 30. And Siemens XP having near about 60, so almost double. But when the patient results we compare, if ROS giving the result of 100, then Siemens give the 1,000.
No, but when you're giving ROS result, you'll be giving that reference interval. You'll be giving that reference interval.
Yeah.
But so the epitopes are different, so this is the possibility of variable standardization.
Okay. But clinician and patients are not understand.
Clinician, I think if you explain clearly to them, they will understand. Patient, yes, I accept, but.
We had not experienced that.
Yep, agreed that interference could also be another factor.
Yes. Yeah. And moreover, in your maintenance, you should see if there's any carryover effect. Does this happen when you do it after a particular type of parameter, or does it happen on a regular basis? So sometimes carryover variables after certain parameters, this is sort of a thing is seen.
And some IVD, some IVD has, for that particular parameter, they are reporting the low values for.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. They say that last session is the best session to speak because the audience are the sincere, are the ones who will stay till the stoic last talk. So I'm glad to be speaking to you. Triple test. I see the results of these tests secondhand. The patient gets the test done, the pathologist hands over the report, the obstetrician sees it, and then it comes to me as a fetal medicine expert to make a decision on that report. And then I realize that there is so much of confusion and misunderstanding that happens, both at the level that the report is handed over to the obstetrician, who finds it extremely difficult to interpret these reports. Which one?
The green.
Okay, I circled that to tell you, people also use the word triple test to mean all screening tests. Whether it's a dual marker or a quadruple marker, everything is called triple, almost like that it is used as a generic name for all the tests. All right. Screening test for chromosome abnormalities in pregnancy is unique and very, very different from the routine kind of test that either you do or what obstetricians do. Both in the performance of these tests by the laboratories, the way the final results are presented, the misinterpretation of the results by the clinician, and of course, finally, where do I point? Suddenly gone 1 minute, gone too many steps forward. Okay.
Is it right?
Misinterpretation by the clinician, and then comes the misunderstanding by the patient, of course. And then results in a distressed patient who runs into my clinic saying, my baby is abnormal, weeping away. A distressed clinician, sometimes when they find that they what they told the patient and what happens in the end, they will say, it's not my mistake, it's the lab's mistake for giving the wrong report. And pathologists will say, it is statistical, not diagnostic. So everybody passes the buck around and nobody actually answers the problem. So here is a test which is shrouded in more misunderstanding than understanding. So I think we need to actually begin at the very beginning to understand, why do we do these tests? So why is it that we are so bothered about Down syndrome? Of course, the screening test also looks at two other things. But the principal thing is, why are we so interested? I'm also going to talk about the need for a screening test. Why can't we have a test directly to tell us whether the mother is carrying a Down's fetus or not? And why do we need an in-between screening test? Screening test in the context of antenatal. The obstetrician conducts many tests, and when he is presented with a screening test report, is complete. He completely confused. And how these reports are generated, how test reporting has evolved over the period of time, where pathologists have tried to help obstetricians understand the report, the question of wrong report within inverted commas, and some special issues, if we have the time in the end to look at. Things like, why do I need a test? A patient might come and ask you, are there errors in a report, repeating the test, etc., etc. So let's go to the first one. Why do you need to look at Down syndrome? Because Down syndrome is the commonest condition resulting in significant handicap. Those are the numbers. And if you look at the graph, as the maternal age advances, the Down syndrome incidence also increases. You will, for example, realize that at the age between 41 and 42, it's not as if there is a 50% risk or something like that. It's just a 1% risk. And at age between 38, 39, you will find it is 0.5%. And at 34, 35, it's about 0.25%. It's not the number that is, the percentage that is important, and the handicap that this problem causes, which families find it difficult to cope with. The mental handicap, the cardiac problems, the skeletal problems, etc. So therefore, this is the reason why we have started screening for Down syndrome. And now, of course, we have a new dimension. If you miss the test and the woman delivers Down syndrome, maybe there are medical legal implications. There was a very funny story that came up, that a Down syndrome boy actually sued his mother's obstetrician, saying that you should have picked this up so that I was not born, and that the pregnancy should have been stopped at that stage. So what is the need for a screening test? Why can't we just do a diagnosis for the test directly? How do you diagnose Down syndrome? Classical features these babies have, flat face, etc., etc. These are so classical that when a cat gets Down syndrome, it also has the same features. You can see a flat face, low set ears, etc. But these features are difficult to pick up in a pregnancy. By the time they appear in sonography, the pregnancy is pretty late, and it's not always 100% that sonography can tell you whether there is Down syndrome or not. What gives you the definite diagnosis, of course, is by chromosomes. A chromosome will show 21 number chromosome is 3. So if I have to diagnose a fetus to be having Down syndrome, I will need to know the baby's chromosome, which means I need to essentially do is to put a needle into the placenta, get a biopsy, or put a needle in the amniotic fluid and get a sample. Both these are invasive tests, and both these tests cause miscarriages, and one could lose a completely perfectly normal pregnancy. Therefore, these cannot be taken easily and lightly and applied to every antenatal patient who comes into your clinic. Therefore, there is a method or a need for something that will help you discriminate who should have these invasive tests to get a definitive diagnosis. Screening started actually from 1960 when they were able to get from amniotic fluid cells from which they could get a karyotype of the fetus. And the simplest and the best way that they decided they would screen patients and offer amniocentesis was, of course, age. Any woman above the age of 35 was offered amniocentesis. Why 35? Because at 35, the risk for Down syndrome is 1 in 250, which is exactly the same risk as the risk of amniocentesis. So they said anything less than that, it is too risky to do the test, and anything later, you are absolutely able to offer this. But the problem of using age as a discriminator resulted that only in become 51%. 49% of the time, you miss them, because there are several women who deliver babies below the age of 35 who can have Down syndrome. Age, therefore, was not a useful indicator. So people were looking at many other types of assays that could be done or some tests that they could do. And that's the time when alpha fetoprotein came as a way of detecting neural tube defect. And they found that the alpha fetoprotein values were very high when the fetus had neural tube defects. And this was more than 2.5 times the multiples of the median that happened. But when somebody sat and looked at all this data, they suddenly realized that low values of alpha fetoprotein actually pointed out to a large number of Down syndrome pregnancies as well. So that was the beginning of using a biochemical way of seeing whether we could differentiate which pregnancies could be at risk for Down syndrome. AFP was the first one. So screening test in the context of an obstetrician who is actually looking at a pregnant woman, generally two broad categories in which they do, preventive care of giving folic acid, etc. But the screening test for genetic diseases, especially Down syndrome, is something new that most obstetricians have started doing it now. If you look at the broad tests that they do, I'm just giving you a general thing, you can look at it in two different groups. These on the top are all quantitative with reference ranges, whereas the bottom ones are qualitative. But when it comes to Down syndrome screening, it's an extremely different, complicated thing for an obstetrician. Obstetricians are very simple-minded. For them, it's very difficult to know what a probability is and how to express it to a patient. You see, they are very used to looking at reference ranges. If you give them a hemoglobin and said, that's the thing, they'll say, yeah, now I can understand. When I'm at that thing, I'm going to say something else which is not related to Down syndrome. Obstetricians also have a problem. They will look at hemoglobin and straight they will look at the WBC count and the platelet count. What they fail to look at is the values in between, MCV, MCH, for example, because therein lies the clue for picking up beta thalassemia carriers. And in this country, we continue to deliver thousands of babies with thalassemia major because obstetricians will not look at that value to say, hey, this patient could be a carrier. And I think I'm partly responsible is also the pathologist for not pointing it out to them to say, in a CBC report, look, the MCV, MCH is low, check this patient out to see if they are thalassemia carriers. Anyway, that's by the way, that's because of my interest in thalassemia. So, when the report comes, the laboratory feels that somehow they have to help their colleagues, obstetricians, to understand what this probability report is. How do you generate reports? The reports are generated by first you measure biochemical values. As you know, PAPA and free beta HCG in dual markers, HCG, AFP, and histriol in triple markers, and added inhibit now in the quadruple marker that has come about. Now, these are first estimated in absolute terms, and then you are using a software with an algorithm using multiple variables like patient's age, gestational age, etc. And using these, what you're generating is multiples of median. So these facts about patients' data is extremely important for these kind of reports. So these are how it is used. All these facts are taken into consideration. And therefore, there is a need for contextual history. The lady who spoke earlier, she said the importance of history that a pathologist should do. But it is nowhere important than here, because I will show you just now how these things can make a difference. Using these, multiples of median values are generated using all these factors. There is no other situation where a date of birth can affect the final result. Here's a woman. Alpha fetoprotein, HCG, and estriol gave a risk of 1 in 545. So this is the risk at which one would say perhaps there is less chance for the woman to have a Down syndrome baby. But look at that, it's the same values. And what is the difference? Because the pathologist had not noted the date of birth correctly in the entry. And that made a significant difference. And this woman, in fact, in a subsequent slide I'll show you, we did an amniocentesis and turned out to be a Down syndrome. Had we gone by the first report with the mistaken age, we would have actually ended up in the woman having a thing in spite of having done a screening test. So this is extremely important, the contextual history. How the test reporting has evolved is also partly because of the way the obstetricians look at things. When you gave them a report, they didn't know what to look at. There was no little value to tell them this is the thing. There were all kinds of information. They were very confused. So pathologists started writing little notes like interpretation at the bottom to say, look, here is the line you have to read. Some of them started then putting little boxes to show them this is what you should look at. Then the boxes went up and down and various different configuration. But the best was this guy who said for the doctor, he said, any other person can read, but for the doctor, they will want to give an information. And he said, first trimester screening for the given sample is negative. This is the most dangerous thing to tell an obstetrician. If you tell them screening test is negative, they only know one screening test, and that is pap smear. If pap smear is negative, everything is okay. So when somebody tells them first trimester screening test is negative, they straight away declare baby is not Down syndrome. That's the end of the story. And that is the most dangerous thing to do. Negative versus low risk, two words with completely different meanings. Here's a case where you will see the level is very, very close to the cutoff. In that time, they were using 1 in 350 as the cutoff, 1 in 373. So what is the cutoff? 350. So they said risk below is cutoff, screen negative. Obstetrician said no Down syndrome, but the patient insisted we did an amniocentesis and it turned out to be a Down syndrome. Okay, this is very, very, very important when you use words in your report. See, the other problem is when you present an obstetrician with a thing which says MOM, they get very confused. They don't know what the hell this is. They know milligrams and things, but if you say multiples of median, it is immediately they stop thinking about it and they will say, let me go on to read something else. The MOMs or medians are constantly revised by your own population that you are screening in your own clinic. So as the number of patients you do increases, the medians keep fluctuating. And then converting those medians into risk estimates. So there you have the MOMs which are then made into risk estimates. So the pathologist reports. Obstetrician will follow those reports blindly, whether it says positive, negative, whatever. And then the poor patient goes and delivers the Down syndrome baby. So everybody then jumps up and says, how the hell did this happen? And this is where the importance of cutoff comes. If I take normal babies, 10,000 of them, and look at the blood values of AFP in the mother, when the mother was, say, in the second trimester, and plot a graph, I will get a graph like that. Those are all the normal. And if I do the same thing for Down syndrome pregnancies, that's how it will come. The problem here is that there is a huge overlap there between normal and Down syndrome. This is a fundamental problem of all screening tests. compared to others like diabetes, etc., I mean for blood sugar, etc., their overlap is very minimal. So the question then comes is at what AFP level should one consider Down syndrome? So if I say I want to be very this thing, that at the end of the normal graph, I will draw my cutoff so that what I pick up is only Down syndrome. What happens is that you are missing a whole lot of those Down syndrome babies. So there are too many missed, very high false negative. But if I say, no, I don't want to miss so many Down syndrome, I rather put that cutoff at the other end where I will make sure I don't miss a single Down syndrome. What I do is I'm picking up too many normal pregnancies and saying, perhaps you got Down syndrome. And when I suspect, the thing I'm going to do is to do an amniocentesis. So there are unnecessary amniocentesis being done if I shift it that side. So the problem of the cutoff is thus. If I put it there at 1 in 10, there it is, the extreme thing after the normal finishes. A lot of Down syndromes are missed, but no unnecessary amnios are being done. I go to the other extreme, at 1 in 1,000, I don't miss any Down syndrome, but I will do too many amnios and I'm likely to lose pregnancies because I'm doing too many amnios. So those are normal pregnancies I might lose. So people said, instead of these extremes, let's put a thing in the middle. So use some Down syndrome you might miss, some excessive unnecessary amnios you might do, but this is sort of a via media. And that is how the evolution has happened now that we have kept this 1 in 250. People have this belief, especially obstetrician, that 1 in 250 is like a Lakshman Rekha, that's it. And I'll explain to you, show it to you in the next graph what happens. In England, for example, they keep 1 in 100 as the cutoff. When they do that, obviously they do miss many more Down syndrome, but they do very few amniocentesis. Why? Because amniocentesis, etc., they have to pay for. It's under the National Health Service. So to them, to keep that 1 in 100 is more cost-effective to have a screening program that way. Whereas we want to have the program at about 1 in 250. We follow the American standards. Here you have 1 in 250 cutoff. And what the common perception is that all values, any risk higher than that means Down syndrome. Anything below that means no Down syndrome. So a value of 1 in 251 is just below that, and you will declare it and say no Down syndrome. 1 in 249, you will say is Down syndrome, do amniocentesis. In fact, the reality is not like that. The reality is like that. The reality is most likely, likely, unlikely, most. That is the gradation in which the results are. And this concept is extremely difficult to be expressed to obstetricians to say, just don't go by that 1 in 250 line as if it's a very strict line. And so many cases happen. I have personally have had patients at 1 in 450 where I have said, I don't think there is a chance of Down syndrome. And the patient has gone and delivered a Down syndrome. I have rarely ever seen anything happen at risks lower than 1 in 1,000. So it is not a yes or no. So when you write a thing to say low risk, it doesn't mean that there is no Down syndrome. Or when you say high risk, that there is positively Down syndrome. There are patients who go by the high risk and gone and terminated pregnancies because the report said there is high risk for Down syndrome. All that low risk means is that the chance of it occurring is low, but not zero. This is important. And when we say high risk, the chance of it occurring is high, but not that every pregnancy at that high risk will have a Down syndrome. So to make this a little more predictive, they said, let us add many more. So it started with AFP, and then they started adding more and more things to see whether we can get better things. But still, essentially, they're all a probability. Nothing is going to say no zero risk, or anything is going to say 100% risk. It's not a diagnostic test. This is another question that happens. Obstetricians ring up the pathologist and ask them, I sent you a patient for Down syndrome screening and you are giving me some report called 1 in 450. What the hell does it mean? So this is very important that they understand that this is how the whole thing is worked out. The software converts their MOMs into risk estimates, and those risk estimates are expressed as those numbers. So, taking the patient's date of birth, etc., etc., so many of the parameters, plus those chemicals that are analyzed, the patient is then picked up and put into one of these boxes. That is what happens in these tests. So what you're giving, the test does not give an individual patient's risk, but the risk for the group to which she belongs. This is extremely difficult for people to understand. And this is what happened, that she belongs to. So when patients come and ask me these, I tell them, if you're standing with 500 people in a room and I'm going to throw a stone, it's going to hit somebody's head. If you are standing with 100,000 people, the chance it'll hit your head is very low. But if you are the only one standing in the room, it'll definitely hit your head. So this is the way you will need to explain, because patients find it extremely difficult. Forget obstetricians. They won't understand this, but patients equally have a great problem understanding this. So when you order a test, whether the patient is carrying Down syndrome, that's not the answer it gives. It just says the probability of most likely, as I told you, and I sometimes feel this is the way the report should be written. Don't write low risk, high risk, just write most unlikely that the patient will be carrying a Down syndrome. Of course, we then converted into numbers to make it easier, and then we put a cutoff and created more confusion. So, we know that there are a lot of limitations in these kind of testing, but can we not avoid making it worse, as I told you earlier, because the output from the test depends on all those various inputs that you give, like the age, etc. So here is the multiples of meat, this is the risk you've got, which has been influenced by so many factors, and if one of those factors change or multiple factors change, that risk is going to go either up, down, whatever, by just one factor. So the important points when obstetricians order a test, and when you guys are picking up that information, is to know that the dates that are being given, the pregnancy weeks, are based on ultrasound, and that there is weight of the patient mentioned, date of birth. This is very, very important. And other influencing factors have now come in, diabetes, whether there are twins, IVF pregnancy, whether there have been a previous, all these can be put into the software, and then the final things can be worked out. But these are important. Date of birth and the ultrasound-based date are the most important thing. Now, sometimes reports come to me and I look at it and I find that there is an error because nobody has asked the patient, have you got a problem when this test was done? If the patient is bleeding because of a threatened miscarriage and you do a test at that time, you're going to get wrong results because there is a temporary connection between the fetal-maternal thing and AFP values, etc., will change. So when you're doing a test also, it's worthwhile to inquire. If the patient is bleeding, these tests will not be accurate. Another important thing, it's very fashionable amongst obstetricians, if the patient has the slightest spotting, to give them HCG injections. So the obstetrician is giving HCG on one side and you are estimating HCG on the other side. And you can have a completely wrong information if you don't take that into. Of course, single pregnancy versus multiple pregnancy, wrong dates, etc., what we saw. And sometimes the tests are done too early or too late, and you saw the same story. This patient, how you can see there, the earlier one had 1983 and actual date of birth was 1973, and that made the difference, and that turned out to be a Down syndrome baby. This is another new thing that I find is coming up. There is the age risk, the biochemical risk, and then a final risk. The software gives that. Many laboratories report it like that. Now what happens is, they look at the age risk and then they look at the biochemical risk. And here, you see this example, 1 in 99. The patient is at my doorstep saying that I want an amniocentesis. Actually, when they combined it with the ultrasound finding, that risk did not deserve an ultrasound. But once the obstetrician has raised this thing with the patient to say, yes, you have a high risk of Down syndrome, it's very difficult to make them, convince them to say, look, you don't need the test, because your final risk is what matters. This causes a lot of heartache for people like us, as to tell the patient that do not worry, that's not the thing. So many other laboratories will not report that. They will only say what the background risk is and what is the final risk is. They do not say. And if you ask me between the two tests, which is the better test? The biochemical risk, the detection rate is 61%. But if I have the combined risk with the ultrasound, the detection rate is much higher, 83%. I rather depend on the combined risk to be able to interpret whether I should do an amniocentesis or not. In this patient, however, I did do the amniocentesis because one half of parameters was rather low. And patient by then had been so anxious, and I said, if I don't do it, God forbid she gets a Down syndrome, it's going to be a problem. So we did it, and we just got the report to say it's normal. So that's not a problem. But these are new things which we are finding. Sometimes the report comes too close. And you have the habit of writing these things at the bottom. Kindly correlate clinically. You can't, there's nothing to correlate clinically. This patient is pregnant, she's got a blood test done. There's nothing that I can correlate clinically. Sometimes they write with USG findings. You can use ultrasound to help you when there is a very close borderline situation like this, because ultrasound markers, some of them point to us to say there may be a Down syndrome. For example, there are several markers that one could use to see whether there is a possibility of Down syndrome in addition to doing the biochemistry. But if you use ultrasound and say the biochemistry says yes, there is Down syndrome, risk is high, but you say let me do ultrasound and the ultrasound says no, there is no risk. And if you use that to avoid doing an ultrasound, 56% are missed. Because ultrasound sometimes does not show everything right now, it might show as the pregnancy progresses. So to use ultrasound as a way of avoiding amniocentesis in a high risk situation is very dangerous. But there are some markers, for example, if I see them, I will be very tempted to do an amniocentesis. Absent nasal bone is a very, if your marker might say the risk is low, but if the ultrasound tells me there is an absent nasal bone, I will do an amniocentesis because the pickup rate is 61%. So tomorrow, if we do get a software where we can put all these things in addition to what you're already doing, still, it will still be a probability test. And who is always that question going to be, who is that one in 1,000 or one in 10,000 or whatever? There are questions like, is it worth repeating a test? Now, I just had recently a doctor who came to me with three laboratories on the same day she visited and did the test. And those are the values from those three labs. And you will see that two of those labs agree with each other. And the third lab came out and said, no, the risk is very high. The first two, the A and C said it's low, but that one said 1 in 135. And when we looked to see why does this happen, then people said that these medians have to be constantly revised by the software. So a lab which has got a large number of tests that they are doing of screening are likely to have better medians. And also they said, I'm not an expert on this, but they said that the analyzers need to be audited, etc. These might be the reason why the differences occur, why different analysis method, different softwares, different algorithm, why three different labs would produce three different reports. Can you press that? I think I'm going to stop that. Let me proceed a little bit. I don't think these are issues you guys are going to face. Once more. One more. Okay. There are some special issues. For example, test results are more information than just telling you about the three major problems, Down syndrome, Edwards syndrome, and Patau. These are not the only thing they give you. There is a lot more information that is available if you bother to look. And therefore, it might be worthwhile for you to add this information to give some added value to your obstetrician to say, be careful, this patient has this pattern, so there is highly likely to be a bad obstetric history situation here. Or for example, placenta accreta might occur if there is a high normal with an abnormal Doppler, that these are situations that it might help obstetrician understand. So finally, check the data before you dispatch. Don't please write screen negative, it'll be misunderstood. And look for hidden information like what I told you just now. The words written in the report, low risk is not zero risk, will actually make your clinician think before he tells the patient there is no problem. This is important, you will help them. Of course, the good news is that probably all these tests will be replaced very soon by free fetal DNA. Many of the European countries are already doing it. They don't do screening anymore. All pregnant women just have a free fetal DNA test done, which directly tells them if they're Down syndrome risk, etc. So probably that will save. But if you're ever in a jam and you need help, that's my email. Thank you.
Sequential screening is necessary, or it should be quadruple marker is compulsory for every double marker test, or it should be sequential screening like US is following?
See, when the patient comes, it depends. If they come early enough in pregnancy, if the patient comes, I would prefer to do the dual marker.
Okay.
Because the dual marker is a far better test that I can take action quickly if I find the dual marker. But the dual marker, as I told you, the combined risk is a much better risk than a simple dual marker, and that cannot be done till the patient is about 11 and a half weeks pregnant. And then, if it comes through, the results come in a couple of days' time, I have time to act. I can then do a chorion villus sampling or something and give the answer before she crosses 13 weeks. The whole idea being that if I pick up something wrong, then the only solution I have is termination. Okay. So 13 weeks is the sort of outer limit. So that way, a dual marker is a much better test.
Okay. But in US, there is a method of sequential screening. Every double marker goes for the quadruple marker in the 19 weeks.
You know, even in England, they do that. They do a dual marker test, and then they go on to do a quadruple and then do what is called as an integrated. I don't think that is available yet in all the labs here. Some labs are offering it, but we don't do that. If you find a dual marker test is clear, we do not pursue the patient to do any more tests, unless there is a high risk factor somewhere.
Okay, and even in US also there is a practice like they don't reveal the final reports of the dual marker until they come for the quadruple marker.
Some of them do that, but we don't, not in this country. We do the dual marker if it is clear there is no other risk factor, the patient straight goes for an ultrasound at the fifth month and that's it. There's no further thing done. It's not necessary to do a quadruple at the same time.
Okay.
So good evening everyone, and thank you very much for staying back. Just wanted to convey a big thanks to Professor Natarajan for taking over the last salvo of the clinical part. We are starting with the non-clinical section here, and fortunately he was not the last, but he was the second last, and the last man here is me. So we're going to talk about something on the clutter in marketing in terms of healthcare advertising, and you're not going to find anything which is very, very peculiar to healthcare marketing in terms of inviting people to come to their hospitals. I'm talking about how HCG is a chain of oncology group of hospitals in India. We are about, across the country, we are about 18 hospitals along with Infertility Chain, which is Milan, as well as we do run TriStar Diagnostic Labs. So, when we are looking at healthcare advertising, we are talking about how HCG in the field of oncology connected with patients in a non-traditional terms of utilizing a different platform to make people aware about oncology and what their work has been. So I would like this to be more of an interactive session, and of course the Q&As can be done at the end of the session, but in between I might ask you to please give me some answers, and I'm sure you would be able to do that. Since we are in Bombay, I hope some of you are movie buffs here. Any movie buff? People who would be watching movies? Okay, fine, thanks. So we have a lone man here. Thanks a lot, sir. It's a very easy one. Okay. So we're going to talk about something called cancer. So when I talk about cancer, what is the first thought which comes in your mind? Anything, whatever comes to you in your mind when you think of cancer. Sure. Tell me. Oh, so he's bang on target. What really reminds me of is this. So you're right, sir. It reminds you of this tall gentleman along with his friend, and he always has this Babu Moshai. And we start off on this. Kindly watch this and then we'll discuss cancer.
यहीं मिलूंगा जयचंद, इतनी जल्दी पर्दा नहीं गिरने दूंगा, इतनी जल्दी पर्दा नहीं गिरने दूंगा। डॉक्टर साहब, अल्लाह करे ये शर्त रघु का कर्जी जाए, ये शर्त रघु का कर्जी जाए। डॉक्टर साहब,
हाँ कहते हैं कभी कभी प्रार्थना चलती है, और इस वक्त मैं जानता हूं सब वही कर रहे होंगे। नहीं होने दूंगा। छह महीने से तुम्हारी बकबक सुन रहा हूं मैं, बोल बोल के मेरा सर खा गए हो तुम। बोलो, बातें करो मुझसे, बातें करो मुझसे, बातें करो मुझसे।
बाबू मशाय, जिंदगी और मौत ऊपर वाले के हाथ है। जहां पड़ा उसे ना तो आप बदल सकते हैं ना मैं। हम सब तो रंगमंच की कठपुतलियां हैं जिनकी डोर ऊपर वाले की उंगलियों में बंधी है। कब कौन कैसे उठेगा ये कोई नहीं बता सकता है।
ओके, सो नो प्राइजेस फॉर यू सर, दैट वॉज करेक्ट, वेरी वेल डन। एंड नाउ फ्रॉम मोर ऑफ अ क्लिनिकल पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, do you guys remember the name of the cancer? Yes? Excellent. So we are among one of the most erudite and most well-read clinicians. Absolutely right. It's lymphosarcoma of intestine. And I think when we were kids, that was the name which we had grown up with. Now the intention here was not a kind of analysis of what the disease was after seeing a picture or a movie clip. The intention here was to understand how a cancer patient was being, or how the disease was being perceived. If you realize, cancer was being perceived as the end of the road. It had, by that time, in 1940s, 60s, it had joined the trail of other dreaded killers of 1940s, like TB, smallpox, leprosy, and plague. And people had this thought process that if you have cancer, you are, that's the end of the road. What was his family and the people around the cancer patient thinking of? They were told you have to care for the patient. The way it was projected was that there's nothing available for him. We were talking about you have to pray, you know, that's what. Or if someone will say it's God's will, they will say and say, people will come and walk into your room and they'll say, you can try this. Or you have, they will be on a motivational pitch, will say, why can't you overcome with this? Let's do this, you can do this, you can try this. But no one was actually talking about what the patient was undergoing. And it meant the end of the road for him. But that's the perception which we wanted to ask for. We wanted a straight paradigm shift which we were talking about. We are talking about changing people's perception about cancer. As one of the leading cancer service providers across the country, we said, why not let the cancer patient voice what he is undergoing and what he is feeling? Is he really in such doldrums the way it has been projected through the movies? Is it really the end of the road for him? We wanted to salute the spirit of the survivor which was there. So what did we do about that? What we did was, we looked at technology, which is on the forefront of technology in terms of cancer care. We looked at the current trends. What are the ones which are influencing a person's perception, people, patient? And then it talks about the target group, which is the cancer patients. We said, why can't we combine all three of them and see what we can bring up as a thought process amongst the people who are treating or who are undergoing treatment of cancer. So we thought about getting real heroes, actually cancer patients, that we have seen, heard and experienced. Let's understand what they have. And each of these stories which they are going to talk about, because cancer is something so rampant here, one of us would have either an extended family member or a friend who has been experiencing, has been a part of this disease. And it has touched us somewhere always. So we share these stories, we ask them to share these stories across continents, gender, race, nationalities, all bound in the survivor spirit, people who are fighting cancer, who have overcome cancer.
Shout it from the rooftops. Shout it in the streets. Tell the world how you said cancer are running with its tail between its legs. Because you are a survivor. And your story fuels the fight against cancer. Survivor stories, uncut, bold, inspiring. Visit hcgoncology.com/selfv.
So we started with something where we called selfie program. We asked these people to share their stories, and we used technology. And the smartest technology tool which we have in our hand is a smartphone these days. So we asked them if they could record their experience on how they have overcome the disease and how they are part of the normal lives in a 1 minute clip. How they have faced these challenges and how they are now part of the celebrating their life in a day-to-day process. We invited through ads, we ran the clip which you saw in the movie halls, televisions, newspapers. We asked them to come be a part of SelfV, where you could come, share your, upload your self video. The V in the SelfV would also meant was victory, a self-victory over cancer. V is also the video, which they have to do. And with the encouragement, hope and support, we got a phenomenal response to this. Currently, this program has been running for almost, this is the third year in continuation. We have got more than 500 entries per year from across the world. And this year it is touching, most probably going to touch about 1,000, because we're already getting a lot of videos on that. So these are the survivor stories, people who have faced cancer. And now I would like to recollect the conversation which was there in the beginning of the presentation, where the Indian hero was dying on a bed with 10 people, with one of his closest going over, one is praying, the other one is holding him and literally throttling him by asking him to speak, the kind of melodramatic voice. And then we said, why don't we have people who are actually sharing their stories across the world? The first gentleman is from Mongolia. He is here to present his case. His name is Tim.
Hello, ACG. Greetings from Mongolia. My name is Tim. Remember me. As sly as a fox, as strong as an ox, as fast as a hare, as brave as a bear.
Sugar and everything nice, as old as time, as straight as a line.
So he shared his story, and I'm sure. So I'm sure the story which you saw over here is nothing in comparison to what you saw at the beginning of the clip of this presentation. He's sharing the pictures from his real life, what he's undergoing after his treatment. We not only had the gentleman from Mongolia, we had people from here too.
Have faith, hope and charity. That's the way to live successfully. Good day everyone. My name is Ruchi and I'm cancer free. The word cancer itself brings shivers to all, isn't it? I self-diagnosed my tumor last year and was told that it was malignant. I could not believe initially that it could ever happen to me. First thing that came into my mind was, if the treatment goes on for 9 to 10 months, will I lose my job? My doctors advised that if I take care of my diet and myself, I could work and get treated at the same time. Yay! Surgery seemed a cakewalk, but chemo was trickier. With regular guidance of my doctors, love and encouragement of my family, friends and colleagues, it helped me get through those 6 painful cycles of chemotherapy and radiation. I'm cancer-free since I got diagnosed in the initial stages. So my friends, it's very important to get yourself diagnosed, examined by mammogram or pap smear test regularly. You could have a problem, you have to find your own solution. Because ignoring the problem, it only aggravates, and sulking never helps. You have to fight your own battle and live life to the fullest. My friends, life doesn't get easier, you become stronger. Shakti.
So we had Ruchi from Delhi talking about what she has been able to do. Then we had friends from
Hi, my name is Monica Malindo. I'm 28 years old, mother of one. I was diagnosed with cancer in 2012. I underwent gastroesophagectomy to remove the tumor that was 252 grams. With help from Faraja Cancer Support Trust, I was able to have 6 sessions of chemotherapy and 30 sessions of radiotherapy. I am now cancer free. I would like to advise young people that cancer is not a disease of the old. I had cancer at a young age, so young people should go for screening. And also coming from Africa, where cancer is viewed as a result of witchcraft, cancer is not a result of witchcraft. It's a disease which is curable when detected early. My husband was my primary caregiver, and I would like to say a big thanks to him, and also to all other caregivers out there who stand with their patients. I would like to say a big thank you.
So we had people from all across the world walking across, sharing their stories, talking about how they have overcome cancer. They were the true heroes. And we said, why don't we get all these videos together and let's select who would be the part of that in terms of a winner among them all. It became into a competition very soon.
Hi guys, my name is Preeti and I'm 17 years old and a childhood cancer survivor. I was 3 years old when I was diagnosed with retinoblastoma and I had my surgery and in which my right eye was removed and I completed all my chemotherapies. After completion of my treatment, I started with my education. I completed my 10th, my 12th, and now I'm pursuing a graduation. Now, after completion of my treatment, I am leading a normal and healthy life without any issues regarding my health. And my message to all is that being a cancer survivor is nothing to be shy of. We should always try to explain to people that it is nothing, but we are also normal like them and lead a normal life.
So she's right. She's part of us. And these are the cancer survivors, unlike what we saw in the movies and the perception we have about cancer patients. They're like you and me. So among all these videos, obviously, we got a beautiful, wonderful support from all across the world. From all these videos, we had to pick someone. And we had to think of a victor among the victorious to felicitate about his video. It was not about what he won. It was about his video. It became a competition.
Hi friends, my name is Siddharth, an IT professional and a marathon runner for the last 7 years. I was detected with cancer 6 months ago and had to go through a life-saving surgery in which I lost one of my kidneys along with some peripheral tissues as well. And since that day, I run a blog as well. It's called youcanfightcancer.wordpress.com. Now, here are the six simple steps that I've followed since that day. Number one, believe in Almighty. God has managed to put you in this situation. He'll take you out as well. Number two, hope for the best, but be prepared for the worst. Number three, have a strong willpower and a positive mindset. That's really important. Number four, thank your family who will always be there to support you throughout this journey. Number five, thank your friends, your well-wishers who've prayed for you. Number six, take each day till bedtime as if there is no tomorrow. And believe me, I fought cancer and so can you as well. So don't give up. Cheers. Bye-bye.
So he was a winner who won across all the guys who submitted, and this was the last year winner. And you know what he loves to do? He loves motorcycles. And in the end, this is what he won. He won a Harley Davidson. And he's still riding across the streets of Delhi on Harley Davidson, where he, the last year's winner, last year's winner. This last year, we had a Mahindra Scorpio to one of our cancer survivors based on her videos. And this is a very strong competition now. It has been covered across the newspapers. It is not talking about HCG as a brand or a hospital as a brand. It is actually talking about celebrating the survivor spirit of cancer patients who are like anyone else. This was covered across the newspapers. Of course, we were awarded for our venture in terms of the thought process of best marketing campaign. And this is an international award at Dubai Festival where we were recognized for our efforts. And this story continues this year also.
What is strength? People believe that strength is the absence of weakness, that it is measured when you are at your strongest. They believe it comes from winning, reserved for the lucky few, while the rest of us stand by watching. You can forget that. Strength, it's in each one of us. It's not earned without a struggle. It lies within, waiting. Strength, it is what defines you.
So Siddharth won himself a Harley Davidson, which he still rides along, and you just now saw, he's in the part of our promos, he's doing it just to invite other cancer survivors to spread the message that cancer is nothing but just a normal disease and you can overcome this. We now move on to something very, very interesting, and that is called breast cancer. Not in terms of the cancer I'm talking about the path of communication which we have used. As you all are aware, breast cancer is among the most common cancer globally. It is the second most common cancer among women in India and the most common in the major cities across. One out of 22 women risk developing breast cancer, and 1 lakh new breast cancer cases are detected in India annually. With such mind-boggling statistics, we need to make patients and people aware how important it is to be aware of self-breast examinations or curbing the cancer right at the nip. And the key is, as I said, awareness. And our whole focus was to create that awareness. And who would be a better thought process in this, in terms of to make them aware? People who are endowed with breasts are not aware the importance of it. So we thought of a very different community to convey this. We thought of transgender community. This community is basically, internally, they want to be a woman. And when you talk to them, all of them have undergone either surgeries or undertaken some kind of tests or therapeutics just to make themselves look like women. They have undergone a lot of pain to be a woman. And when they convey what they are undertaking as a program or as a process, it becomes far more relevant to make the women in India aware that it is very important to undergo breast examination. So this community came together in support of us. They said, we will be the ones who will participate in this program to talk to the women who are blessed with breasts, those who are not. And we took their support and had this.
रोज संघर्ष अपने हक के लिए, अपने सम्मान के लिए, अपने अस्तित्व के लिए। मैं जन्म से नारी नहीं हूं, पर जन्म से मुझमें एक नारी बनने की चाह थी। नारी बनने का यह सफर मेरे लिए आसान नहीं था। हर मोड़ पे मुझे तकलीफों और कठिनाइयों का सामना करना पड़ा, और यही वजह है कि मैं अपने नारीत्व की हर पहचान की जी जान से रक्षा करती हूं। मेरी इस पहचान का एक अभिन्न अंग है मेरे स्तन। इसीलिए मैं हर साल अपने स्तनों की जांच कराती हूं। नियमित जांच आपके स्तनों को कैंसर से बचा सकती है। आप भाग्यशाली हैं कि आप जन्म से नारी हैं। अपने नारीत्व की हर पहचान की रक्षा करें, नियमित समय पे स्तन कैंसर के लिए जांच करवाएं।
This app along with the help of our community of transgenders, and they were the ones who spread the message, and I think it was one of the most befitting podium for them to talk from, the less fortunate talking to the fortunate ones, telling them how important it is to convey them. We opened, these transgenders were across the malls, they were distributing pink bangles free of cost to the women there. And when the women would arrive, reach a stall, they would talk to them about breast cancer, telling them about the disease, asking them to get themselves screened regularly. We even launched an app which was shared with the patients, with the cancer group, as well as with the people who are walking in, the women, which can be shared online and downloaded. So you can self-examine yourself. It tells you how you can do that. This story was picked up across the newspapers as well as media, where it saw a strong correlation in between the community and the spread and the route which we have taken to convey the message of cancer, not to be perceived as the end of the road, but as an opportunity on creating awareness and how to fight it off. We also partnered with Zivame, it's a lingerie brand which talks about preventing breast cancer. And they were the ones who were again partnered with us. We did the routine stuff of getting us biggest, largest pink ribbon formation in the world, where we did a pink ribbon formation which was acknowledged in Lingpa Book of Records. We had, of course, the celebrity endorsements with celebrities coming and joining us. This is all without any financials. It was done out of their personal favor in terms of their feeling for the cause. But I think the biggest bender of the whole story is the stories which had a global connect. We had patients from Pakistan coming down for bone marrow transplants, or the Yemeni girl who came down for her bone grafts from Yemen. The social media took our story by storm, especially the advocate.com, a leading LGBT community group newspaper, and they picked our story on breast cancer awareness, where we asked transgenders to be a part of it. The Logical Indian shared this on the website. Of course, there were Twitters which were talking about the hoardings which were put across Bangalore, talking about how cancer awareness is being created by this media. I hope you remember this about 2 years ago, when it was mandatory to start launching this at the beginning of movie, where smoking is injurious to health. The slide was run, and HCG was the partner for this program, and with Ministry of INB, we were the first ones who were taken over, and this slide was run across every time you watched a movie or during the movie breaks. I now move on to something different, which is head and neck cancers, and there we are talking about the voice box cancer, which is the second most common cancer. commoner and below economic group. And in this disease, most of the patients lose their voice box during the treatment. So we thought about getting an artificial device, which is normally costed at about 25 to 30,000. We were able to do it with our local R&D. We were able to price it at $50. When you do something like that, you need to convey it to the people. And to do that, you use a strong media where the voice recognition, where the people are known by what they said. And that's what we talk about.
This is the voice of India.
And brothers of America. I regard myself as a soldier, though a soldier of peace.
My countrymen in East Asia, while I am in Tokyo, I desire to address a few words to you, and I have no doubt that you will give them due consideration.
Unfortunately, thousands of these strong voices are silenced every day by throat cancer. Not many can afford the treatment they need to get their voice back, and they suffer in silence. It's time we changed that. For the first time in India, there is a voice prosthesis device for the world. OM is a next generation voice prosthesis device that offers a new lease of life to those who have lost their voice from throat cancer. Because the freedom of speech is every Indian's right.
My voice is my birthright.
My voice is my birthright.
You saw Ramesh, and about 2 weeks ago we operated a patient from Maharashtra remote area who was speaking after 25 years. Just because he was a lack of prosthesis he could not afford. And now affordability was no longer a challenge for him. Ladies and gentlemen, my whole interest here is to tell you about cancer survivors are a part of our normal day. They are not something different. For them, the life is not the end of road. The whole story which I shared with you was people who are celebrating life, people who are part of our lives. They are not in the doldrums. They are not people who are coughing blood and dying on the bed. They are like you and me, riding motorcycles on the streets, having a normal life, eating pizzas. They don't need your sympathy. They need to be a part of you and our lives. This cancer group of survivors is always there. And I would love your respect and your intentions to always support these people for cancer care. Thank you very much for giving your ears to me. Thanks a lot. You have any questions? So this is all in-house done. Thank you.
What does ACG mean?
So it's a chain of cancer hospitals. It's called Healthcare Global. So we do about, as I said in the beginning of the presentation, we have cancer hospitals across India. Thank you very much for spending your time. Thanks a lot.
I'm going to request Dr. Vimar Shraina to please join us on stage to hand over a token of appreciation to Dr. Saxena.
So if you don't mind, thank you.
It has been really wonderful. And especially because I work in a similar area. So we are creating a bone marrow donor database registry in Delhi by the name of Jean Bandhu. So it has been a pleasure, It has been a lot of learning for me. So I would not have afforded such a good teacher. Thank you very much. Thank you for giving us such a good.
If you don't mind, do we have any of the cancer survivors of someone who's had a cancer in the family? Is there any person here? Can you please join me on the stage?
To the end of the third APPI Annual Conference 2016. for last few words. Is there any last few words to be said? Ladies and gentlemen, it's been both a pleasure and privilege, and thank you immensely for being part of this conference and making it successful. As ma'am has said, we shall see you once again next year, larger numbers, larger workshops, and of course we shall not only see you, many, many more people will join our family. As of now, thank you once again. Have a phenomenal evening ahead. Thank you again.